Swiggity sorty, let's get that booty.
Hello everybody, welcome to another episode of the Slim Cogcast. It's me, Slim Cognito, and let's get into what I've been playing this week. So, I've been diving into Half-Life 2 to finally, you know, play it and finish it. My initial playthrough of a year is back in 2014 did not work out because the previous machine that I used to have could not even handle that much. So, now that I have finally finished it for the first time, I not only went into that, but I also did episode 1 and episode 2, and then I went back to play Blue Shift, because I never finished it, and I gotta say, it's not bad. It's good integral stories, you know, very interesting. The physics puzzles are so ahead of their time that I noticed that even I came across situations where I said, okay, there's no way that this is gonna be the solution to this puzzle, you know? And I just assumed that this older game from way back when was not, you know, that ahead of the curve. But turns out that it was true. And it was a breath of fresh air. It was a breath of fresh air because the game trusted me as the player to understand gravity, density, buoyancy, balancing, torque. Like, it expected me to know these things in physics, and a lot of games used to challenge you that way. They used to reinforce the things you learned in school and be able to apply them in a useful way, which helped you look at the whole world in a scientific and mathematical sense. At least that's what games used to do. There's not much player agency anymore, so you can't really trust a player to know. There was a puzzle in Blue Shift where a bunch of dynamite was attached to a blast door, and the fuse that connected the dynamite to the detonator was severed, and you had to find a way to set off the explosion. My initial thought was, with modern game design in mind, my initial thought was, okay, how about I toss a grenade at the dynamite and maybe it'll cause a chain reaction and trigger the explosions. And that didn't work, because of course it wouldn't. A grenade is just fragment, it's a fragment grenade, meaning it's just shrapnel. It's not a literal explosion or combustion, so it wouldn't do that. Then you have my second solution was to try to shoot the detonation and the dynamite, and that wasn't the solution. So I stopped and I had to think about it. And I looked around in the environment and I saw a barrel that was pushable. And I said, wait a minute, are they asking me to bridge the connection from these two wires using this metal tin or barrel, you know what I mean? And lo and behold, that was the solution. I was supposed to push the barrel over the two endpoints of the wires, and it bridged the connection and allowed the vulture to go through, and boom. And I'm like, I don't think there's a single modern game would have done this. Especially just leave it open with no tutorial, no instruction, just say go and do it. You know, that's astounding, honestly. And to be fair, this was in Blue Shift, so by comparison to Half-Life 2 and the both subsequent episodes, it's like I was witnessing the casualization of player agency, or the diminishing of such. Just make it way easier and not really reinforcing problem solving skills, you know. Even though this is not something so in depth, like it's not that deep, it's just using metal to bridge a connection, and it's still debatable if that tin was made out of a conductive metal in the first place, but that's just aside from the point. Is at least it reinforces a basic principle that you can expand on later if you played it as a preteen or child, is that metal conducts electricity. And I guess I kind of missed that design. And it makes sense now why they don't really know where to take Half-Life at this point, because that's pretty much the staple of it. It expects its fan base to be somewhat of a science or any type of academia nerd, you know, in a sense, to be able to enjoy it. Because it's not really about the gunplay at all. The gunplay really takes a back seat to all of the scientific themes and overarching, on a micro and a macro level, presentation. It's very centered, it's sci-fi centric. So how would you translate it to modern game design when part of the appeal of sci-fi is the person using what they know about science and then putting a little extra spice to it to enjoy it. I now understand how the fans of Half-Life feel, though. Once I finished Half-Life 2, I was skeptical. This is an old game, so this is spoiler territory here. But once you reach the top of the tower and the core explodes on you, Gordon Freeman, and Alex, it just ends in a freeze frame and G-Man talks to you, and that's it. It ends you on a cliffhanger and you wonder, okay, what's next? And then episode 1 came along and it starts exactly where you leave off, where the Vortigans show up and they save you. And the thing about the Vortigans is they're a bit of a deus ex machina for the entire plot, because they took a moment that I'll get to later, I'll tell you. But basically, to speed things along, you're pulled out of that explosion by them using the ability to freeze time, I suppose, and reposition you into safety. In episode 1, you work your way out of there, etc., etc., which, to be fair, kind of went on a bit long, because once you finish 2 and you're in there for so long, you get tired of looking at that environment, but you can excuse that, because that's bridging from one game to another. And it pretty much is, if you play them right behind each other, it feels like you've been in that same area for way too long. But otherwise, the game is well paced and you don't stay in one environment too long. So that's another thing to give it for amazing game design, which is the best thing about linear games. And now, once you leave there, you get outside and there's a huge war going on, and everybody's, the city's ruined. The Resistance is doing everything they can. You meet up with Barry and, you know, you try to get people to safety, etc., etc. And you catch the last train that you can find to get out of the city and into, you know, to try to get to safety and rendezvous with your father, with Alex's father, excuse me. And, you know, it ends on that note. Literally, the entire episode 1 is about getting out of the city and away from the explosion after you stabilize the core to buy enough time to get out of there. So you help a bunch of civilians by escorting them, well, Resistance fighters, escorting them into a train that can get them out of there, and you and Alex have to find a separate train to get out. Which, honestly, it's debatable. But anywho's, yeah, it served a great purpose for the story. And on your way out, it, of course, explodes. The whole city goes up and the train crashes. And then it ends episode 1 on another cliffhanger. Then, once again, you start episode 2 and you're in the wrecked train. You find Alex, you both survive, and you're out in the wilderness, or the woods, so to speak, or the outskirts of the city, where you find yourself having to find a path to, what was it, White Forest, which is where Alex's father is. So your first job is to try to find some way to traverse that huge amount of land. Eventually you find a car and use said car to get to another resistance, from one Resistance base to another, and they help you do so. And it was pretty good, actually. A good experience. It was solid, it worked, and the simplicity added so much more than the outdated graphical detail and animation could ever take away from it. Like, it felt great, you know. I tried to watch one review on Half-Life 2, and it was very stunted in the bias that Half-Life 1 was superior because they didn't like the evolution of the sequel because of the awkward pauses between dialogue, etc., etc. But honestly, because it was such a graphical advancement, one of his biggest complaints is that there was awkward pauses between dialogue, and there wasn't. It was just, these characters now have lip syncing and animations that bring them to life when they do use their voice lines. So, you know, of course it may add to a bit of the uncanny valley, because when a person is talking, you don't exactly have to stand there and wait to listen to the whole voice line. And that becomes a bit jarring, but it's a part of hard work that a lot of team of people use to animate it. And the most that you can complain about is awkward silences ain't it, you know? So we can't really like it's not making an excuse for them, but that type of advancement is supposed to be celebrated. And it really paved the way for a lot of things. I see a lot of game design emulated Half-Life like crazy, especially since first-person shooters were so popular then. and everything became bog standard after that. Like, Half-Life changed the game and pretty much took first-person shooters to its peak at the time. Until the single-player experience linear first-person shooters peaked with Half-Life. That's probably why it has such a good cult following. Now, beyond that, there was a scene in episode 2 where Alex was, for all intents and purposes, she was mortally injured and at the door of death. And once she was close to dying, she basically, the Vortigern showed up again, which is why I call them a Deus Ex Machina. One random Vortigern shows up and he says that he can heal her. And then him healing her required more Vortigern, so he called out to the rest and then took her to a place where he can heal her, which was one of the more interesting gameplay aspects, probably the more fun gameplay moments out of the entire set of the game, the entire Half-Life 2, including both episodes, because defending her from the four tunnels of, I forget the name of the bug creatures that come out of the ground, was actually fun. It was actually fun, and it ramped up the stakes, and it was good, tense situation and well directed. So yeah, it was good. They heal her back up because you had to go down into some nest of those same bugs and get some type of what did they call it, essence or something, but anywho, some form of ambrosia that is produced within the hive of these here creatures, and it's supposed to be the key thing to be able to heal her with. They bring her back, she comes back from near death, and you continue the adventure. Eventually you make your way to White Forest, but not before a very interesting section where you have to fight these, what do they call them, prowlers, I think, of some sort, with these big, tall, like alien-like tripedal creatures that stomp around, and they're at least like 20 to 30 feet tall, and they're accompanied by some these smaller, what would they call, predators or something. Anywho's, you had to destroy the smaller ones, which were the so-called predators. I'm just calling them there for now because I don't remember their name, but these so-called predators are accompanying the prowlers, and by the way, those predators are one of the creatures that caught Alex and stabbed her and mortally wounded her earlier. So now they go from being this big scary enemy and then gradually become an enemy that you can become comfortable defeating, and then they become a normal enemy throughout for the rest of the game, which was a great progression of introduction of antagonist groups. So anyway, people are stationed at these different spots on the map, and there's about five different areas, maybe six, and it's like a base defense type of section, but you're doing it in first person in a car. And the most tedious part about it all was you had to use these bombs made by the scientists, and these bombs were only teleported in at certain points at these junctions on the map while the enemies come in. So with these bombs, you had to launch them with the gravity gun, switch to a ballistic gun, and shoot the bomb in order to detonate it, and it will immediately destroy the prowlers or whatever. Now, riding around in the car, you had to pull up with the car, put the bomb in the back of the car on a little bracket, and then put them in the thing, and then you gotta drive the car to a position where you can hit them with the bomb and then blow it up. But the ads that come with them will shoot the bomb if you don't get rid of them first. I said all that to just say that it was interesting and kind of tedious, but it turned out fun in the end because it felt rewarding once you defeat it, because it wasn't directly difficult, just management skills. Basically every bit of the gameplay feels like it was well thought out before it was executed. And I hadn't seen anything done like it before that time, so clearly they wanted to stand out and be unique. And I think they achieved what they were going for, and that's usually the hallmark achievement in game design these days that you really should look for and hope for, because oftentimes a game can fail just by being a poor imitation of something better. So I appreciate that. Another game that I've been playing, Apparently The Fall is free on the Epic Games Store now. It was a indie Kickstarter game that met funding and was its only console release was on the Wii U back in 2014, I think. And that game is a good little piece of sci-fi horror if you love the rules of robotics and you know, AI ethics and whatnot. It's a good piece of it's a good short experience, and I would highly recommend it. Now let's hop into the news for the week, and we're gonna run things down. And first things first, Gotham Knights delayed for a year over here on thewolvesgameboard.com. Gotham Knights was slated for 2021, I think, and now it's moved to 2022 release. The co-op Gotham games featuring the four of the Bat family left behind after Bruce Wayne's death. So there's not much else to that in that article, and yeah, saved you a click. But I feel like that's worth talking about because I have been looking forward to that, and I would like to see what they do with it. And anything with Nightwing is or Red Hood is always worth the time. Next, over here on GameRant.com, Apex Legends adds Twitch drops. So basically the most important part is this paragraph here when it comes to the drops. And for those who don't know what drops are, it's basically rewards you get for watching Twitch streams of a certain video game. Very normal, like in the, I guess we could say Hyperscape, even though the game's kind of dead. Or I'm not sure if it is dead or not, but I don't really hear much about it. But Hyperscape used to have drops where you would get keys before it came out during beta, and they had situations where viewers could vote on what happens in the game. So yeah, here we are. The rewards themselves are based on viewership time, awarded based on the amount of hours watched. Each item revealed so far is for the trickster character Mirage. Though fans are expecting more to come down the road, after 1 hour, players will earn the lifetime wins tracker. 2 hours earns the rare honorable mention badge. 3 hours unlock the rare number one banner pose. And the final drop, 4 hours watched, is the legendary metal collector banner frame. So yeah, basically we're going to be getting some stuff during this event. It's going to be taking place on March 27th during the winter circuit playoffs. So yeah, gonna have to catch that when you get the chance. Next, over on gamesradar.com, PlayStation buys Evo fighting game tournament. Basically, just to sum things up and keep it simple, PlayStation has bought Evo, and it's still, although being owned by Sony, it's still going to be open to all platforms. But that, let's hope that doesn't come to any conflicts, because Evo itself is like it's business involved between Nintendo, Microsoft consoles, etc. So hopefully, let's just hope that Evo isn't just gonna be a Sony wank fest. That's not gonna be okay. But yeah, there you have it. Next on this docket, over at the Wolves Game Board once again, Square Enix reveals get the Mississippi out of here. Life is Strange True Colors. Man, I gotta catch up on my Life is Strange. I've only played with the first two, I think, and they were hella interesting. I did love it. It was a good story, very, very profound and inspiring, and very good writing. Overall, some micro things could use a bit of tweaks, but still, it was good for the most part. When it comes to like some straight up, how can I say, it's a slice of life anime of video games, and it ain't bad. And I would recommend it to those who have never given it a try to try it. So yeah, True Colors was announced, and apparently we have a new protagonist, and she has different types of powers, and basically she's just able to feel people's feelings. I'll let you make of what you want to make of that. And yeah, it should be interesting to see. Hopefully they'll explore some concepts that we don't really get to see often while using this concept. So yeah, that's the entire docket. Everything kept short and sweet as possible. I wanted to talk more about Half-Life, but I guess we'll have to, I gotta find a way to really be able to just talk to y'all about these games whenever I get the chance, because I want to make a better format for this. I want to change directions, but keep the same goal. and I think the channel needs to move in a different direction. And there's a fire burning inside of me about certain things that I want to talk about, but I just don't, and I need to. So I'm working some things out, and eventually we'll get there. But all in all, it's just everybody out there, please, if you don't listen to anything else I say, if there's something that you want to do, please don't waste time. Do it now. Tomorrow does not exist, but you know for a fact that today is real. And that not only means do, but also don't let someone else take your purpose. Chase your purpose. Your purpose is what gives you what you need and want. Chasing everything else will be the price of your life purpose. That being said, everybody take care. And as always, remember the channel motto. Intentions are the most important. Actions ain't nothing but loud. And words don't mean a damn thing. Take care of yourselves and peace.
If your metro don't trust you, I'm gonna shoot. Beautiful morning, you're the sun of my morning, babe. Nothing on the warning. Beautiful morning, you're the sun of my morning, babe. Nothing on the warning. I just wanna be liberated. I'm sorry. Tell me who in here can relate. If I fuck this model, and she just bleached her asshole, and I get bleach in my t-shirt, I'ma feel like an asshole. I was high when I met her. We was down in Tribeca. Sugar under your skin if you let her. Sugar under your skin if you. I don't even wanna talk about it. I don't even wanna talk about it. I don't even wanna say nothing. Everybody gon' say something. I've been waiting to say nothing. Yeah. Remind me where I know you from. What you looking like? Can you owe you something? I know just what you want. I wanna wake up with you in my.